Welcome to the third match of the evening. We're on Frost, ladies and gentlemen, spawning to the top left-hand corner in green, playing Terran for Euronix and Austria. It's Sylvanas. And oh my god, what the fuck barbecue is that? It's purple. It's Miyako playing for France and LDLC. But it's Protoss! What the hell is going on? And now you're not mistaken, it's actually totally correct. This is Miyako's personal challenge for Season 2. Trying to win the FSL without using her main race Terran and playing filthy Protoss instead! How could she? How could she? So we'll see what she's capable of with her non-main race. Scouting with the probe already, while Sylvanas just building the barracks. Sylvanas probably as surprised as we are on Miyako playing the Protoss this season, but of course it has been announced for quite some time, so if you were actively following the FSL webpage, you should have already known about this. But if you come here only for the juicy broadcasts, then this might catch you as a total surprise. So, Summon Ethics Core already going down. Another pylon in the background. He wants to have some defensive structures, just in case that Liberators might slide in, or even just the drops. Mine drops even close to the mineral line. Miyako knows her Protoss. So Command Center on the low ground, as we were talking about. By Sylvanas here, we've seen her do it again and again. Nice little barracks placement here, a little bit behind the main ramp, or a little bit away from the main ramp, more accurately, so that she will be able to produce a lot of units, but her opponent won't necessarily be able to see it. Okay, Reaper is already there. Miyako not really paying attention or not even caring. As long as the Reaper is not attacking any probes over here, it doesn't really matter that much. Oh, unfortunately for Sylvanas, was just wasting a lot of time here. Could have actually taken down maybe a probe or two in the meantime, or at least trying to keep these probes from mining, but thus she just gave her opponent's Mothership Core and Adept enough time to get out, and now the Reaper shouldn't actually be able to deal that much more damage. In the meantime, Probe just got a good scout of the situation at the ramp, but yeah, like I said before, she doesn't really know about the second barracks, but yeah, it's not all too uncommon to have the second barracks up before the factory is down, so nothing that Miyako really has to worry about that early on. Robotics facility in the making as well. So, more interesting actually to see where Sylvanas is actually headed at. I mean, on this map with these spawning locations, I'd rather bet on a Cyclone coming out of that factory pretty early on, because Sylvanas is normally pretty paranoid about... She's pretty paranoid about warp prisms flying inside her main base, warping in adepts, and which Terran isn't. So yeah, pretty early, pretty often she just opts for a quite early Cyclone, just to deal with these kinds of drops. But not this time around, just goes into Reactor earlier on. Warp Prism already on the way, but of course she might still be able to get everything out. She has her timings down, especially against Protoss and Adept builds. So I think she just knows that she will still be able to get out a Cyclone once this Reactor is done, and it should pop just in time before the Warp Prism arrives at her base. In the meantime, Miyako just taking a third base. Good usual Protoss stuff, just going up on three bases while trying to harass using the Warp Prism over here. Even getting the Gravitic Drive upgrade, and it seems as if Miyako actually wants to go for the thing that enrages a Velo to deinstalling StarCraft 2, which is the Disruptor Drop. So Yeah, Miyako knows what annoys a Terran most, so she has no fear to use it against her enemies now, being the traitor on her race, and just abusing Protoss bullshit on her Terran, on her poor unsuspecting Terran victims. Okay, we'll see how this is going to work out. Okay, one disruptor is already out. Does she want to wait for another one? Even double disruptor drop. This is going to be quite interesting. Okay, this time around, no cyclones, so color me wrong. But Marines are now out. We have the Medivacs in position as well. Sylvanas still a little bit paranoid, doesn't really want to move out. Okay, finally just loads up all of these Medivacs. Might actually hit the anti-timing here. Wow, and look at that. Look at that War Prism speed. Ha ha ha, my god. Is that a racer? Okay, actually good for Sylvanas here, just realizing what's going on, but she can't really drop now. The War Prism actually being almost, is it almost as fast or even faster than Medivacs on speed? I don't really know. I mean, okay, Miyako now tries to make something happen, just parks the Warp Prism somewhere over here where Sylvanas can't really catch her, but of course she can also produce just a Viking or two and might even be able to shoot down that Warp Prism with all Miyako being, without Miyako being able to deal actually any damage. So she really has to unload these disruptors now, or otherwise she might even lose. No, Vikings just too slow! Vikings are just to look at that racer. My god, is that speed prism fast? That's almost ridiculous. Have a look at that. Okay, Medivacs now on the way towards the third base, just trying to plant down the Marines over here. Nothing here to defend, really. Everything that Miyako actually wanted to do is inside that warp prism over here, and Sylvanas actually has a Viking in position, and we'll also see it coming with the sensor tower over here, even has a missile turret in position as well. Okay, photon overcharge seems to drive away the Marines for now. Adepts are also in the way, but there is the big disruptor Nova, killing off at least 8 of these workers. But of course the War Prism got shut down in the process, and it seems as if only one disruptor made it out, but at least it got halfway decent worth of it. Now it just dies, but it was a really big investment there. I mean, 8 workers is kind of a good hit, especially since her opponent is still on 2 bases, but yeah, it was definitely not worth it. Losing 2 disruptors and a speed prism for only 8 workers, I rather doubt that was worth it. But of course, in the meantime, Miyako got what she wanted. She has her third base up, it's kind of secure. There's this widow mine still in the mix, which is a bit pesky there. Don't know if Miyako actually knows about it. I think she would have already taken it out with the disruptor shot over here. Okay, now even getting a good hit, and there are the 5 workers for Sylvanas as well, so instant revenge. Sylvanas now moving across the map. She has a Viking and a few bio forces here. Yeah, and it now almost actually comes down to Miyako's disruptor ball. If it hits quite well and gets most of these army units, she should be in a good position, especially with the second disruptor as well. If she doesn't get the disruptor hits, it could get a bit tricky here. But of course, yeah, that's just the best thing you can do, trying to lure your opponent into the disruptor shots. I mean, Protoss AoE play is mostly about luring your opponent into your AoE. Be it storms, be it disruptor shots, you normally want to have the Terran engaging towards you and then just fire a disruption Nova right into the ugly face. But sometimes you just can't do it. The same with storms. The only reliable AoE which you can actually attack with are Colossi, and they got nerfed pretty hard. So with Colossi alone, you normally are not able to take down a good Bioforce. Not if the Terran has made a lot of mistakes or lost a lot of income early on. So, good drop here by the Manas. Ouch! Actually, yeah, ooh, Disruption Nova not really hitting as good as it could have. So just the little click at the last moment, but at least unpowering 2 gateways, not losing too many forces, so safe and secure damage, always something you want to do. So Sylvanas in the meantime has already been able to produce a few liberators over here, will now get a good siege position, the rest of the army units are incoming, but it's only a really small force, so I feel as if Miyako should be able to take out these liberators quite easily. Okay, nice little lure here, actually just getting a few of these stalkers underneath the incineration zones, and then there was bio standing right behind it that could take down a few of these stalkers, but still probably not worth it losing both of the liberators and a few bio forces just for a few stalkers. Not really worth it. So Sylvanas again trying to apply some pressure with some medevacs over here at the north end of the map. Now there's still no fourth base down here, but a third base already down for Sylvanas, so she now has the possibility to get everything up. No upgrades here for Miyako as well. Miyako totally relying on the AoE damage of her disruptors, while Sylvanas is almost at 2-2. Extended thermal lens incoming. Like I said before, in addition to the disruption novas, you normally also want to have some reliable AoE that is available all the time and not only every 30 seconds. So yeah, some of these units might use prove quite useful there. Okay, does Sylvanas actually know? Yeah, she does. Okay. Knows about the fourth Nexus down here, will easily take it out, no chance for Miyako to hold it. And that Nexus actually was quite important for her. I mean, her main base is running dry, her natural base also pretty low already. The only really good mining base is the third one, and she desperately needs to defend it, but she also needs a fourth base. In the meantime, Sylvanas should already be working on one, but isn't. Just wants to get the Ghost Academy, and it seems as if she just wants to close out this game on three bases for good, if I just can read this correctly. Okay, Miyako just taking the front pylon, but it gets immediately scouted and cancelled. Oh no, maybe not even cancelled. Just losing the pylon 100 minerals for free, ladies and gentlemen. In the meantime, Miyako trying to establish a fourth base over at the north hand side. But there are two medevacs in position, so they will probably deny this base even more. And now things actually become a bit more difficult for Miyako here. I mean, she has a lot of disruption novas. If these novas just all find their goal, wow, a lot of mines in the mix as well. So this really is a death zone right now. No chance for Miyako to engage whatsoever. But of course, with the help of the disruption novas, she might still be able to attack inside into these liberation zones. Yeah, so that is just trying to do the best thing she can, trying to dodge the disruption nova shots, but she can't dodge all of them. It's easier said than done. Wow, great hit with a nova there, taking out three mines at once. In the meantime, we have a drop here in the main base, taking out at least one forge, maybe even getting the Stargate here, unpowering two more gateways and the Stargate as well. It has to leave behind a few of her forces, unfortunately. Still might have been worth it, at least getting the forge and delaying of some of the production and only losing one of the medevacs and troops inside. I think that was kind of worth it. Resonating Glaives on the way, 3-2 upgrades for Sylvanas, which will just strengthen the damage output of this bio by such a significant margin. So yeah, and then even 3-3 in the making, we now finally get the second upgrade for a Protoss armor. In the meantime, Miyako again trying to get the fourth base up. This might just haunt her in the long run. I mean, thus far she's managed to deal a good job keeping the Terran army slow, keeping the Terran army low in supply count. And again, Disruption Novas just annihilating most of the bio forces. But yeah, once the Disruption Novas are out, this is always what haunts Protoss. If you don't have enough reliable AoE damage and your Disruption Novas are out of shots, the remaining bio force, if you didn't manage to kill it, it will just steamroll over you. And this is what actually happens to Miyako now. Nothing that she can really do now. This game is doomed, ladies and gentlemen. That's how quickly it can go. Without AoE, good micro here by Miyako, trying to make the best out of these Blink Stalkers. Wow, might actually even be able to hold it this time around. Magnificent Blink micro there by Miyako, being able to hold off that bio force that was almost ripping through her units here. Still, finally she's managed to take the fourth base. This could actually turn the tide of the battle. It looked very desperate here for just a moment, but Miyako managed to out micro Sylvanas' forces here. Quite well done, but I don't know, she just doesn't have enough AoE damage left, so the second push should actually just kill her, and the second push is on the way. Very soon. Only one Colossus available, and the one Colossus deals some AoE, but not nearly enough. So Sylvanas should just easily be able to stim in, maybe walk around the remaining forces, kill off the Colossus by focusing it down, and then just kill everything that doesn't have AoE left. So, we'll see if it's going to work out or not. A few disruptors in the mix as well. We have more Colossi in the production out of a double robo. So, still, Sylvanas needs to deal something, needs to do something. She has a fourth base out. She should actually rather take a fifth base sooner than later, I feel. But in the meantime, tries to deal some more damage. Just checks for another fourth base over here. Does she know about the fourth base down here? She does, so... Yeah, okay, just checking for a fifth, or maybe even dealing more damage inside the main base. We'll probably again be able to take out that pylon over here. And again, unpowering a lot of these buildings. Okay, there's nothing at home. Last unit has just walked out. Seems as if Sylvanas just wants to distract her opponent, making her move backwards into her own main base while attacking at the third. But Miyako not really falling for it. In the meantime, we have some terrible damage happening. Okay, nice disruptor ball hitting over here. The liberators are in position, but of course they can't really cover everything because the area is just huge. Okay, nice little spreading there with the Colossi by Miyako, trying to take out everything. But as soon as the liberators move in, Miyako just has to retreat. Doesn't have the means of anti-air in order to take everything down. A few more Vikings helping out, fighting against these Colossi as well. Bioforce moves in. Nah, Sylvanas has to be careful. Oh, now even gets it. Actually not that good of a shot by the disruption ball here, but it seems as if Miyako just again has barely enough units in order to hold this, and with the help of the three Colossi now finally being able to take out everything. Nice little micromanagement there by Miyako, but in the meantime, the damage was dealt by the drop. Bases down, not really that important, but especially a lot of these buildings being torn down really hurts Miyako's production capabilities. At least the very important production buildings, the robo facilities, are still there, and she doesn't really have to produce them because, like I said, producing AoE is just the main thing she needs to do right now. So, in the meantime, Sylvanas, Sylvanas, look at the supply lead. It's 159 workers to 64, so economy-wise, actually, Miyako's looking quite okay, but 130 to 58, 3-3 bioforces with liberators, yeah, it just doesn't even matter, even after holding off a lot of these pushes with less units than you would have expected her to have. Miyako has to GG out, and Sylvanas takes the first game. King Sejong Station is the second chosen map, spawning to the top left-hand corner in purple, playing Protoss. It's Miyako. And to the bottom right-hand corner in green, playing Terran, it's Sylvanas. Leading 1-0 after a drawn-out macro game on Frost, where she finally was capable of overwhelming her opponent with bioforces. Let's see what she can do this time around. Miyako sending out an early probe, making herself ready for a gateway expand, it seems. But just wants to get inside the base, wants to get a good scout on the gas timings, and maybe even being annoying with that probe over here, tickling away at that one little SCV. Ooh, Sylvanas even pulling two workers, one for scouting and the other one to drive away that pesky probe over here. So actually Miyako retreats completely, so it seems as if she doesn't really want to get the scout in the refinery. So this must mean that she wants to go for some sort of proxy build, probably oracles, I feel. Because after seeing that her opponent goes for a wall in anyways, I think the best way to handle this is to avoid the wall in completely by building a proxy stargate and then harassing your opponent using oracles. Could also go into a double robo build, because she personally hates it when it hits her as Terran, so we'll see what she wants to do this time around. Okay, SCV just gets the scout, sees that there's no base out yet, which should actually worry her quite a bit. First Zealot even out. Okay, Sylvanas now scouts like crazy, wants to get a good check. I mean, she should actually get up here. This is like the most prominent and typical proxy location over here where you normally hide your probe. But unfortunately, Sylvanas doesn't really get it. But she knows that something is up, of course, so she builds a bunker just in case. It's probably expecting some sort of pylon rush with the help of a mothership core and a few adepts. And maybe actually this is what Miyako plans to do. Okay, Sylvanas finally found the proxy location, but the probe is no longer there. Okay, there's the mothership core coming. So yeah, it's going to be pylon rush. Okay, three pylons in position already. We have two more marines on the way. Okay, Zealots are already in place, so yeah, can't really take down that bunker anymore. Sylvanas instantaneously pulls the probes, the workers, just tries to get rid of these pylons as soon as possible, but I think it won't really help that much. I mean, even getting one pylon doesn't really help. There's the mothership core. It's already collected 89-90 energy now, so the first overcharge gets thrown down. Ooh, and Sylvanas will lose so many workers to this right now. TvP even focusing down the workers as long as she can, and the mothership core, of course, will have the possibility to throw down another photon overcharge right afterwards if she wants. Yeah, the marines get out. As soon as the marines start attacking, the mothership core just shoots it once more. Bunker is down. The adept will now even help out more. Okay, depot is down as well. More gateways being produced right in Lavanna's face here. And it seems as if Miyako has broken it. GG, and Miyako ties the series 1-1. Galactic Process is our third map, spawning to the bottom left in green, playing Terran. It's Sylvanas. And to the top right, playing the purple Protoss. Off racing after season one, it's Miyako. So, after a cheesy pylon overcharge rush, Miyako has managed to tie up the series 1-1. This actually must be kinda hard, and this is what being part of a competition like this is always a good thing. What did I actually wanted to say? Yeah, I wanted to say that it must be very stressful for a player to lose in such a manner. I mean, every StarCraft player knows how frustrating it is to lose against cheese. We all know cheese is a legitimate strategy. It's something that's in the game for a reason. It's something that has to be here because you need to be able to punish players for too greedy builds. So yeah, it's a legitimate strategy. It's necessary that it's in the game, but it's still frustrating to lose against it. And if you're in a best of five in a real series, and a real competitive series, where you really have the drive to win, it's something that can shake your confidence and can shake your mindset. And you can actually practice this, that your mindset won't change, that you won't rage, that you won't get tilted by something like that. Nice, SCV actually wins in a direct engagement against a probe. Hero SCV, right over here. And yeah, participating in stuff like that, in stuff like the FSL, where you can play best of fives, competitive best of fives, on a weekly basis, that definitely helps you develop as a player tremendously. So maybe this time around we're going to see some proxy buildings. Let's see if it's going to be a Stargate or a Double Robo. This time around I'd rather say... or maybe just a gateway for quick warp-ins. So we see what's going to be. In the meantime, Miyako just has to defend at home against this pesky Reaper over here. No problem with the help of the Adepts, and no real damage dealt. Did the Reaper actually get anything? I think actually it got killed right now, right? As I was not watching. Okay, we just want to see... yeah, okay, it's just going to be a proxy gateway so that Miyako will have some early warp-ins available. And even Blink. Quite interesting, but Sylvanas scans it right away. Does not know that it's Blink. Has now to assume. No. Has now Must now assume, whatever it is. Has to assume now! That is the right word order. Thank you, English, you have not forsaken me. And a robot. So yeah, warp prism. It's a proxy warp prism adept build, it seems. No, actually, what? Why blink then? That's quite interesting. Haven't really seen that often. So it's actually a warp prism? Or maybe even with immortals and stalkers? This is quite interesting. I mean, she could now warp in more blink stalkers. And very early on in the game, it might work out quite well, because with the blink stalkers, she can just always blink away from the early units like Reapers and Marines. I mean, Sylvanas actually knows what's up. She's seen that there's no natural base, so she just opts for the, or just tries to prepare accordingly for the all-in. Will probably not guess that a warp prism will fly in from behind. But there's the cyclone this time around, so the cyclone might even help Sylvanas to defend against the warp prism with a lock on. We'll see if it's going to work or not. But of course, the cyclone not very good against the stalkers, and that's probably the reasoning behind this build. Pretty not quite that common. You see adepts more often than not, but this could actually, with blink together, help out quite a lot. We'll see how it's going to turn out. I mean, the siege tank is in position as well, or is being produced as well, not in position right now, but the cyclone is out as well. Okay, now finally getting the adept, but there the warp prism gets loaded with two probes even. Okay, well, Miyako even trying to make this little push even more annoying than it already is by probably throwing down some proxy pylons, having photon overcharge available as well. So it's cheesy Portos bullshit once more, all over again, the full program. Okay, finally the warp prism gets down. Cyclone just tries to lock on, unfortunately, on the wrong unit. Stays alive for quite some time. She really needs to take down that warp prism over here, but she just doesn't get it. The cyclone goes down, the warp prism is still intact, and that might be just the one single mistake that Sylvanas could not afford to do. Not taking down the warp prism, that was actually the only thing she needed to do. She didn't get it, and Miyako takes the third game as well. When Frozen Temple, spawning to the bottom right hand corner in green, playing Terran for Euronics Gaming, it's Sylvanas. And to the top left hand side in purple, playing for LDLC as Protoss, it's Miyako, who just managed to take off two games off her opponent. Two games off her opponent. With two mean little cheesy builds that were very crisp and well executed. And yeah, we were talking about it throughout the second game, that you need to have a very strict mindset, a very comfortable mindset even. You have to have good self-conscience to deal with that kind of frustration. Having won the first macro game on Frost with a 1-0, leading with 1-0, and then just losing two games that quick in a row against cheesy builds is always something that's going to keep you occupied mentally. And yeah, there are several ways to deal with it, but it's always something you have to grow into as a player, that something like that doesn't affect you too much. I mean, it will affect you, there's nothing you can really do against it. You're human after all, and you have emotions. This stupid stuff that always gets in your way when you want to make clean decisions. But yeah, so you have to deal with it. But that's something you can really learn by playing competitively again and again and again. There's no other way. You just have to get into a situation like that over and over again. And at some point, you normally just do it, or you just give up. You either break, or you will find a way to deal with it. So, Miyako just checking off the proxy locations close to her main base, probably expecting her opponent to maybe cheese her back. But then again, we have to say that I think we've never actually seen Sylvanas cheese throughout the whole Season 1, which doesn't, of course, necessarily mean that she is neither capable of doing it now. But yeah, it would be uncommon for her. We actually, if you also have a look at her stream, Sylvanas, I think, never cheeses. She's mostly only afraid of being cheesed herself, which might even happen once more, and this time, finally, we have the Oracle. I'm not wrong anymore. Thank God it's the Oracle build. But yeah, that's again also what most people, casters, including casters, but also, of course, fans of Miyako, like about her playstyle. It doesn't matter if she plays Terran, it doesn't matter if she plays Zerg, it doesn't matter if she plays Protoss. She just shows us a wide variety of different builds and strategies and tactics, and that what just makes her game so exciting to watch and to cast, of course, as well. So, in the meantime, Sylvanas just with the early secure bunker, the safety bunker right at the front. Just a precautious measure, you never know what a pesky Protoss is trying to hit you with. And there is the Oracle! My god, it's standard Protoss opening on Frozen Temple. How could you, Miyako? Just doing lame standard stuff. I'm so, so disappointed by you. No, I'm not. Okay, so the Oracle is probably going to fly in. There's nothing here to defend. Nothing at all. Well, the... It just might not pop. Just a few seconds too late. The Marines are not in position. There's no turret over here as well. So Oracle flies in. Gets one kill. Two. Three, four, five. Actually, one mule was among them. Five, six, seven. And now finally the lock-on hits, but the Oracle might even be able to get away, not being able to get more hits. Is there still energy on it? Yes, but not enough to kill the mule. So Miyako finally has to fly out, but the damage has been dealt. Six workers and a mule, which is already a very big hit early on. Plus, of course, the pesky Oracle survives and has the possibility to fly back in later, always keeping the Terran army pinned back, which is normally the more important thing. And now actually the second Oracle flies in, but the Cyclone is in place. Very well done by Sylvanas here, just locking on immediately. Still gets away, but hasn't dealt any damage for now, and it seems as if Sylvanas is now just secure for the meantime. Miyako actually not taking a third base right behind it. It cost her quite some resources in order to get out more and more Oracles, so she wasn't really able to gather some money to build a third Nexus behind it, which is usually the more threatening thing about it, that you pin the Terran army back, but then you expand behind it, and there's actually not much the Terran can do against it. And that's normally the uncomfortable position a Terran feels to be in. So, in this case around, Sylvanas already has gathered some medivacs together, has the Cyclone and some Marines in position, so she should actually be able... Ooh, actually, yeah, with three? Yeah, okay, good thing here. I mean, Miyako maybe not sure if she can actually take it out, because with three Oracles attacking at once, with only a few Marines plus the Cyclone, the three Oracles can actually take down the Cyclone before it can shoot down the Oracles, and the rest of the army then just dies instantaneously, because Oracles just shoot down life without a problem. Okay, now finally gets in, tries to deal some more damage, not really getting the damage done. That was actually the worst end of it, trying to fight against the whole lot of Marines here, and now even losing the third Oracle as well. So this aggression should be over for now. So yeah, Miyako might have taken out that force over here, but it was a close bet, so she didn't really want to try it. Unfortunately, taking the even worse engagement down at the natural base. But she still got what she wanted to do, dealt some damage back at Sylvanas' base, pinned her back, and in the meantime she was able to saturate her own base over at the natural entrance. Still Sylvanas ahead in supply lead. She has a few less workers by now, but she has had mules for quite some time, so her income was kind of okay. And now Widowmines and Marines walling across the map, trying to deal some damage. And there's not much at home for Miyako to defend. She even only has one pylon here for Photon Overcharge, one adept just trying to get to just intercept the army, trying to see when the army arrives. And I don't really see how Miyako wants to defend this. I mean, the Liberator is in position, we have mines that can be burrowed right inside the mirror line. Okay, now finally trying to throw down the pylons, but they will probably not finish up in time. Yeah, the most important thing that Sylvanas actually now has to do is just take down the pylons as soon as possible, because the pylons are the only thing that are going to keep Miyako alive. I mean, she has nothing, nada at home. In the meantime, we have adepts that just crossed the map or was just warped in somewhere. I don't even realize because it was just too occupied seeing where Sylvanas' army would move. So meantime, we have the counterattack from Miyako. It seems as if Sylvanas is just forced to retreat completely. Finally, the adepts get inside the base because the supply depot was down. Avoid the liberation zones for now, killing off even a few more workers, getting rid of that turret over here, which doesn't really mean that much. And now finally the adepts should get cleared pretty easily here. In the meantime, we have another warp in there they come from. With the adepts over here, killing off more workers inside the main base, and Miyako still being very annoying with that harassment, shading right after these SMEs. Okay, and now the adepts just fighting mostly marines. Against the marines alone, these adepts should actually just work out quite fine, but not with the help of the liberation zone of the liberator. So another warp in round right over here, and now finally the marines are not enough to fight off these adepts over here as well. Liberator just taking down more and more units, but yeah, the damage has been dealt. I mean, Miyako just only has to pay attention and move out all of these liberation zones once they get set up. Unfortunately, misses a little bit of the opportunity here, gets some of these adepts shot down. The warp prism just dies to a widow mine over to the left-hand side, so no more reinforcements at least. So Sylvanas will finally be able to clear everything up. In the meantime, she still has some widow mines close to her opponent's base and no detection whatsoever. There's the Oracle out, but it's not on the other side of the map. Adept still dealing damage, but not really any significant damage anymore. They can't really take down buildings that easily. And the only thing that Sylvanas has to do now is just be patient and wait a little bit before she can finally just take them out here. Sieging liberators is so nerve-wracking if you don't really shoot anything down. Finally, Sylvanas manages to clear it, but she's still ahead in supply. I mean, it's 83 to 66. She has a third base in position, while Miyako has not even tried to take a third base of her own. Okay, she denies the third base for a little bit longer, but yeah, without having a fourth base, she will just not have a lot to breathe with. Okay, finally the Oracle gets in. Yeah, I mean, it is Harasscraft. Miyako just being annoying as fuck with all her little harassment tools, but harass alone will not kill her opponent. And now she's 20 supply behind. Army supply is better for Sylvanas. Worker supply is better for Sylvanas. She has the third base already up. Okay, DT's trying to deal some more harassment, but it just doesn't work out. Sylvanas has a scan available, takes out the DT as well. And that should be it for the aggression for now. Can't really see Miyako getting back into that game. I mean, her natural is almost dry. Her main base is dry. And like I said, she just doesn't have a third base as a follow-up. So, I mean, she would need to deal game-ending damage using one Dark Templar. And that seems a little bit improbable. So, yeah, just killing off the DT here as well. Finally trying to take a third base, but it will probably just be not enough. Miyako just trying again to pin back her opponent, again delaying that auto command. Ooh, Sylvanas has to be careful. If she loses that third base though, that might turn the tide of the battle, but she doesn't. Okay, just gets it out in time. Yeah, Sylvanas just, again, a little bit helpless at the moment, does not really know where she wants to attack or where she wants to defend more in this case around, but now she has five liberators sieging them up all at once. Okay, Blink Stalkers just blinking out of the liberation zones, taking out another liberator over here. The Bioforce underneath the liberation zones, of course, also helping out. Finally, the second warp prism dies as well. Okay, a few more Phoenixes are in production, so Miyako wants to prepare for liberators as well. But a few Phoenixes alone just won't suffice, especially if we have a Bioforce underneath it. Okay, seems as if Miyako just turns around once more, sees a small weakness in the army composition of Sylvanas and wants to take it out, but couldn't really do it. So retweets once more. Even takes a fourth base right now. Okay, yeah, Miyako knows she needs to risk something from here on out. If she wants to win the game, she won't win it by just normally macroing up behind her opponent who already has a third base in position and can actually just start satirizing it because she doesn't need the workers in her main and natural base anymore. So it's actually insta-saturation at the third base. So yeah, she just risks it and takes a fourth base right away. So does Sylvanas not actually know about the force? No, she just probably thinks that it's only a third base that Miyako has just placed. So is probably not aware of the possibility of a fourth base. So that might actually get Miyako back into the game if her opponent gives her the time or if Miyako finds a way to buy the time. So we'll see if she'll be able to do something. I mean, does she have a warp prism out on the field anymore? No. So no more warp prism harassment. She has an oracle still, so she might be able to make something happen with that. Okay, the DT was probably just checking the ground path of Sylvanas' army and was then just lured into the main army of Sylvanas, getting scanned and shot down. That was probably not done by intent. Okay, another command center also in production for Sylvanas. Yeah, Sylvanas just probably knows that she's in the lead, maybe not quite. So all she needs to do is just play it down, safe and secure, make sure that her opponent doesn't get a fourth base before her, and this should actually just accomplish exactly that game goal. So with the liberators in position, she could just seal off this whole area, and then with the rest of the bioforces, just stim in and stim down the fourth base over here. So yeah, liberators should get in position over here, and here they do. So we have the liberation zones over here. Phoenixes might be able to, maybe, no, not with the marine forces below it, but Phoenixes just don't do jack shit. And now everything just dies down here. Yeah, Miyako had to take a risk from the situation she was in. It could have worked if Sylvanas had not been paying attention, but she was. Very nicely done by her, and now now she can just play it out. Very safely done by her. Doesn't really want to risk an engagement with the Protoss forces over there. So, actually just taking out the stasis ward here, sacrifices one little marine to trigger it, and then she can just retreat, because she now knows that she's one base ahead. And she's at almost 200 supply to 116. We see how low Miyako's income is by the production tab. She only has barely enough money to warp in a few zealots and to produce one little poor colossus trying to take a fourth base down here. Of course, what else can she really do? I mean, it would be even more risky to try to take a fifth base as well and then just cross your fingers hoping that your opponent just will not attack you until you have finally managed to max out on five bases, but it's not likely going to happen. So seems as if Sylvanas just wants to move towards her opponent's army using the right flank once more. Quite interesting here, but yeah, like I said, everything just stands for Sylvanas here. She has the better upgrades, she has the bigger army, she has the bigger income. There's just nothing that speaks for Miyako here. Maybe it's better micro, you know? maybe better mechanics here, but that's just not enough in order to win that game. Okay, finally scans for the fourth base, sees that it's not been taken yet, and will now just stim in, probably just wipe out the rest of Miyako's army. I mean, yeah, the Colossus might help a little bit, but the only thing that Sylvanas has to do actually would only be retreating into the liberation zones. Yeah, just leapfrogging a few of these liberators. All that Miyako can do is just run away from the bio and mostly even from the liberation zones. While she's running away from the liberation zones, the army can just stim after her, wiping her out. Fourth base dies. That was actually the only mining base left. The other fourth dies as well, and now Miyako's down to two bases, one of them not even mining anymore, the other just barely mining. The rest of her army dies, and that's all she wrote. Expect GG any second now. Any second now? Okay, DTs. Still having some fun with DTs. But yeah, there's just enough scans available, I guess. So, hold on. No? No scan? Okay, it seems as if Sylvanas just doesn't care. Okay, no scan available. Oh, how unfortunate for her! Miyako down to 36 supply. Just hacking away, chopping away with the sizes of the DDTs. And there's not much that Sylvanas can do. Just waiting for the one last scan finally kills them all off. And yeah, that should be it. Okay, two more DDTs trying to walk into the middle line, but there's a planetary fortress and a turret. No chance for these TTs to deal more damage. Okay, another TT! No scan! My god, this is so annoying! If I were Sylvanas, I think I would just build a Raven now. Just to do it. But yeah, finally she just moves in. GG, and Sylvanas ties the series 2-2. Welcome to New Gettysburg, the fifth and deciding map of this series. Spawning to the bottom right-hand corner in purple, playing Protoss for France and LDLC, it's Miyako. And to the bottom left-hand corner in green, playing for Euronix Gaming and Austria, it's our Terran, Sylvanas. Let's see what Miyako's trying to do this time around. Two cheeses, one very committed Oracle opening that didn't quite gain her the damage she wanted it to gain. Sylvanas actually defended that quite well and then just crushed her in the macro game after Miyako had been quite behind for quite some time. Not really a good chance to make a comeback without her opponent making a significant mistake. And that mistake would have been just not attacking for like 4 minutes. Which Sylvanas really didn't do, and thus crushed Miyako underneath her heel. So early scout with the probe, so Miyako knows the gas timings, just drove out and returns back with her probe to safety, and this time around goes into an early Nexus, a normal expand build by her, no cheese this time around. So quite interestingly done by her, so we are going to see something new. But a hidden pylon over to the left hand side, something that is quite out of scan range, so it seems as if she nevertheless wants to do something quite tricky with it. Maybe just a Stargate build, so that she will just have the shortest route with the Stargate units. Oh, sorry, the shortest route with the Stargate units across the map, because it's still pretty long due to these air blockers. The route just gets a bit longer than usual. Okay, blocking the bridge with a pylon, that will just make units that are rallied across the map not take the short route. The short route, sorry. Via the bridge, but the long route via the watchtower, and just gives her a little bit more time, especially the Reaper. So like Sylvanas just wants to get in with the Reaper, she can't really get through here, would have to take down the pylon first, but she doesn't really want to do that. Okay, mostly just using the Reaper to check for proxy positions anyways, and I would too after these three last matches. So yeah, quite normal. And there's the Stargate, like I said. Just wants to have the Stargate as close to the edge of the base as possible so that it will take the flying unit a little bit shorter to get to what's her opponent's base. Probably going to be an Oracle this time around once more. And in the meantime, trying to saturate her base, same as Sylvanas with her own natural expansion. And she just goes into Starport and Factory, just the usual good old stuff she has been building throughout the last few games. All the time. Okay, depth is out, so no more chances for Reapers to get inside the base and deal some more damage. There's the scan, quite nice scan, actually gets a good grasp. Not quite out of vision range, it seems. Or did she? Let's have a look. Should have been able to see it just barely. If I think Miyako had just thrown it down a little bit more over to the left hand side, the scan might not have gotten it, but yeah, might have not. Doesn't really matter anymore. So Cyclone will be out just in time, it seems, before the Oracle arrives, and that should just help her. And she actually even has some Marines in position as well. We'll probably then just move the Cyclone down to the natural base in order to defend it there, So yeah, not much that the Oracle will be able to do. So mostly a wasted resource for now. We will see. I mean, there's still a chance to deal some damage here and there, make it worthwhile, but under usual circumstances, it shouldn't. Okay, let's see. Okay, sees that the Marines are here, just moves back immediately. Doesn't want to risk anything there. Oh, Tempest! Oh my god, it's the Roddy build. Well, not quite, but sort of Roddy build. We're going to see early Tempest. This is just so great. This is just a great kickoff to the first day of Season 2. I just love it. Double Stargate Tempest. Not really proxy, but kind of proxy. So, yeah. Ladies and gentlemen. This is going to be quite interesting. Miyako moving out, probably just to get a good look at the watchtower. Okay, and the first Oracle already moving across. So let's see how many Oracles she will gather before she finally reveals what she's up to. Or if she just actually starts to start dealing damage with the first Tempest all the way around. Sylvanas has no idea this is coming. And you actually need a very specific... Yeah, nice tag there with the Oracle. So now the... Tempest, of course, can just use their full range of everything that got tagged, which is very annoying now for Sylvanas. She doesn't even have anything to fight against it. Is mostly starting to produce Vikings, and as far as I know, I don't have that much experience with the build myself, fending it off, but by what I've heard by Roddy, who's almost the inventor of the build, and others, Vikings are actually not the best weapon of choice here, but mostly it's actually Marines, just producing more and more Marines, and then trying to move across the map, forcing the Tempest forces into direct engagements against Marines. But if you, I mean, with double Viking production, you might actually be able at some point to shoot down the Tempest quite well, but if you can't, if the Tempest just focus down the Vikings, three or four Tempests can actually just one-shot a Viking, and then you will just never get enough Viking arms up in order to take down these Tempests, which is like the biggest problem there. Yeah? So you try, you think you can take down it with, you can take it down with Vikings, but you just put so many resources into the Vikings that finally will not be able to take down the Tempest at all if you micro them correctly. And but this is actually nicely done by her, just counter repairing the Vikings mostly. We're getting just some more value out of it. But of course, with the mass repair, she just loses so many resources with the lost mining time and everything around. So yeah, like mass Vikings seems like the intuitive correct response to mass Tempest, but as far as I know, it's not. It's a common misjudgment. So let's see how this is going to work out. I mean, Miyako's still committing to more and more Tempests over here. Okay, now just taking out a supply depot, just trying to deal as much damage as possible from a safe range here. And here again, we have four Vikings, but we also have four Tempests. And now, bam, just shooting down one Viking, and with four Vikings not being enough. Like I said, if you have, like, suddenly 10 to 15 Vikings, they can easily take out that force, but with only four or five, always throwing them in mostly for free, you just throw away resources. But like I said, it's so easy. Okay, in this case, now this is actually a good position here and having added another starport. But like I said, with the lost resources and mining time and everything, she just doesn't have enough resources to produce more Vikings. And now even losing the refinery, a very important gas resource she needs in order to take the Vikings. I mean, in the meantime, she tries to deal her best, just gets out more and more workers, tries to take a third base, but so is Miyako. I mean, she's not... she's still busy at home, not only busy microing at home. Yeah, the Marines just won't do jack shit in here, in defending. But like I said, if you just mass them up and then just move across the map, you will normally just be able to kill off everything that focuses at home. So like base racing, mostly, and then just killing, forcing the Tempest either into direct engagements, and that normally just seems to be the trick. Like I said, it's not my judgment, it's what I've heard by people who regularly use this build, and what they lose to. Yeah, and here we have it, like again, you know, the Vikings just not enough damage, and finally getting out one Tempest, But for one Tempest, you get down, four of your Vikings die. And that's not the thing I have to do in the long run. But like I said, it's easier said than done. If you have never actually faced this situation, and you have never actually played against this, it's so frustrating and annoying to deal with. So, and at some point, even Marines don't really bother you anymore. Once the Tempest count gets high enough, it doesn't actually even matter. Like you see, you can just take down Marines from afar, no problem here. And yeah, that's then the point where you really, really get problems. Okay, now even losing the reactor, so only one more Viking on production. But like I said, it's not really the reactor or the production buildings, it's mostly resources. Sylvanas just doesn't have enough resources in order to outproduce the Tempest force of Miyako here. And she's just losing resources over and over again, while Miyako now has finally managed to get her third base running. So, more and more Tempests being massed. Seems as if Sylvanas gets pretty desperate, doesn't really know what to do, just keep producing Marines and Vikings. But as we've already seen, Vikings not the thing you will be able to take down the Tempest Force anymore. And yeah, just evacuating the main base now, just flying away with the auto command, but unfortunately, by doing so, she will also abandon most of her production facilities inside the main base. I mean, she can lift them off and try to fly them away, but she won't really be able to do so. Every Viking that pops, she just tries to move them out of the Tempest range. But yeah, if Miyako just pays attention, she can always just take them out once they spawn. And we'll now even maybe be able to take down the Orbital Command down here, just taking down more and more workers. Yeah, Vikings fly in, but three Vikings are not enough to take down this Tempest force. Okay, and finally just managed to sneak out a few more Vikings out on the map, and having even reproduced a few of these barracks, or just flown them away, no, just reproducing them. Yeah, and there's the Marine force, but Sylvanas finally gives up, sees she just doesn't have enough, and Miyako takes the series 3-2.